welcome you to church this morning. Why don't you stand and greet your neighbor with the love of Christ this morning?
You may be seated. Well, good morning, church. What a gift it is to be able to gather together for worship this morning. I want to welcome you all to Covenant. My name is Jason. I'm one of the pastors here, and God has called us to be about the work of building a community connecting in Christ. And it is good to be able to connect with you this day in worship. There are two cards in the seat backs in front of you. I want to alert your attention to them. The first is a prayer card. If you have a prayer request that you would like us to come alongside you in, we would be honored to pray with you. If you have something that's on your heart, we have a prayer team, pastor team, staff team that would love to pray with you. Also, there's an I'm New card. If you're a guest, you could fill that out. You could drop either of those in the offering plate as they pass by, and in this way, we'll be connected to one another. I just want to lift up a couple of really brief announcements for you, and then I have an invitation. So we have first, a reminder that next week is our quarterly blood drive. And so if you would like to sign up to give blood, we would love to have you do that. We recommend that you go ahead and sign up, though, because then it can be on the schedule, and it's just more efficient that way. You can just drop in, but if you want to go ahead and sign up, that'd be awesome. The second thing is we have, beginning this week, our women's Bible study launching for our early spring. It's Wednesdays. We have two this year. We are launching in the morning at 9:30 and then in the evening at 6. So if you... if you have never been able to come because you work during the day, this is an awesome offering to be able to welcome all the women of the church, either in the morning or the evening, for Bible study. I hope that you'll sign up there. Begins this week. So on your way in, you received a pamphlet of information. If you're a guest with us, you get to kind of be a fly on the wall and eavesdrop on some family business as a church. Each year in the month of January and the beginning of February, we enter into what we call an annual giving drive. It's a season of stewardship, and we have a time when we consider each together what the Lord is calling us to pledge to the ministry of the church. We have some lay leaders that help to guide that, Malcolm and Laura Jacobson. Malcolm's going to come up, and he's going to offer a word for you. Again, if you're a guest, thank you for being patient as you get to eavesdrop and listen in. But Malcolm, would you come forward and share a word?
Thank you, Jason. Okay, so what is this all about, especially if you're new to Covenant? Well, as Jason said, this is a time of year we take about 3 weeks every year to reflect on what God is calling us to do to financially support all that we do here at Covenant. So a little bit about the process. So as Jason said, starting today, you've got some information. Please spend some time taking a look at this. And thanks to Robin Johnson for all the work she did on this. So in the brochure, you'll see things like, where does the money go? What's the budget request for this year? Now, the fiscal year starts on March the 1st, so it's March through February. So take a look at that. And there's also some information that should help you as you go about prayerfully considering what God's calling you to do. Sorry, I'm out of breath. I was running up here to Jason started, and I didn't even know it. So excuse me for being out of breath. The next three Sundays, you're going to get some more information. You're going to hear from Pastor Jason, and you'll also hear from some of the lay leadership. And all this is going to culminate on February the 6th, so please mark your calendars. February 6th is Commitment Sunday. So that's when we all gather together, and we turn in our pledge cards. If you're with us today, don't throw this away. If you're not with us, if you're online this morning, don't worry. You're going to receive this whole package in the mail this coming week, so look for that in the mail. But if you're here today, we're saving postage. You're not going to get this in the mail, so don't throw it away. Take it with you. And how do you pledge? So just like last year, we're trying to make it as easy as possible. First way is, if you're old-fashioned, you want to do it that way, fill the card out, bring it with you February the 6th, or there's a return envelope in the packet. You can mail it in if you're not able to be here on February the 6th. The second way is to go online. Instructions are in the brochure. I think it's covenantconnects.life/pledge, I think. Few keystrokes, you can be done. Make your pledge securely, confidentially, and then... If you're going to be here February the 6th, go ahead and fill the card out. Just check pledged online, and you'll have something to turn in on Commitment Sunday. So with that, let me talk about the goals. We've had a goal for the last several years in our pledge drive of 100% of the membership making some sort of pledge, irrespective of the amount. And we've got a really good track record on that goal. We've been extremely close to that 100% mark. This year, because of some of the financial challenges that you're going to hear about, and you heard a little bit about back in November, and we had a tremendous response to Jason's comments on that, we're going to provide as much information, you know, as we can. As part of that, we're asking that at least half of the membership faithfully consider taking a step forward, if you're able, to make that first-time pledge if you haven't pledged in the past, or increasing your pledge over last year. So those are the two goals that we set. And Jason, if I've got 60 more seconds here, I'd like to close with a couple of thoughts here. One is, here at Covenant, giving, pledging, it's a spiritual matter. You're not going to have anyone here that's going to pressure you to give a certain amount or tell you what you should give. But I want to emphasize that this morning because this year, unlike maybe previous years, we're providing a lot of financial information about the church. We're doing that because we just think it's important to know what the hurdles are as you go to God and prayerfully consider what your role is. So please take it in that vein over the next few weeks as we as you hear more about the financial aspects of what we're doing here. And then the other thing is I want to emphasize how important pledging is. Giving is one thing, but you know there was a time when I didn't pledge. You know, we gave for the church, but we didn't pledge. You know, I had the attitude of, you know, we're going to give. I don't need to make that commitment up front until I became part of the team that was developing that budget. And it is just, it's almost impossible to develop a budget and much less manage that budget through the year. So please, if you haven't pledged in the past, I hope you'll consider doing so this year because it really helps that finance team in their task of developing and managing that budget. So with that, look forward to seeing everyone on February the 6th. And Jason, I'll hand it back to you.
I want to offer a word of thanks to Malcolm and Laura. They're a stewardship chairs of the church, and it's a role in the church that we don't turn over very often. In the 10 years, they're the third family to lead in that way because we feel like the tenderness and the importance of the matter requires that consistency and longevity. So thank you, Malcolm. Thank you, Laura, for all the work that you do there. And I also wanted to add, it seems as though Malcolm at least alluded to the fact that if you don't pledge to the church, then you might get nominated to the finance team. So I'm not saying that that's true. I'm just saying that that's what he alluded to in his history with the church. But no, we're excited about what God is doing, and we're thankful for all the ways in which your gifts help to support the ministry we share. And let's go to God in prayer as we continue worship. Lord, we ask, oh God, that you would meet with us by the power and presence of your Holy Spirit. Lord, we thank you for your work in us and through us, and we ask that as we worship, Lord, that you would be glorified. Meet with us. Help us to center our hearts so that we would set aside every distraction that would attempt to become a barrier between us and you. But because you are drawing so near to us, Lord, we ask that you would help us to draw near to you. Lord, meet with us in this time of worship. Be glorified through it. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. As always, church, this is a place of freedom to take whatever posture of worship you feel led to today. Let's prepare our hearts for worship, to give him everything that we have. Together we sing.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his presence go before you.
As we sing this last chorus, I invite you to stand as you're able. Come on, church, stand up. If we're united and we are singing this, amen, we agree. Let's be united, church. Come on. We sing amen that together as a body, we agree. Sing this with all that we have. Oh, we sing
amen.
We are so thankful that he is for us, that he promises he will never leave or forsake us. That is a reason to rejoice, church. Well, last week, church, we learned a new song together. A song of thankfulness and gratitude. And when we reach the bridge of this song, I want to encourage you, church. It's such a moment to even minister to ourselves, to pump ourselves up in worship and to make sure that there is no barrier or defenses that get in the way of us giving him everything. And so maybe do a self-check. Just check in if there are defenses or barriers that keep us from fully being free in our worship. And freedom looks different for everybody. That's between you and the Lord. So I encourage you, even as we start this song, just connect with him. Ask him, God, is there a defense or a barrier that's getting in the way? Lord, would you help me remove that? Let's sing this out together. Church, if you need pumping up, this is the part. I invite you to raise your hands in worship to him, a sign of surrender to him. Come on, raise your hands up with me, church. You don't need permission, but this is your permission. Come on, join us together. Sing this out.
Oh, come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy of me. Lift up your song, because you've got a lion inside of you. You get shy on me and lift up your soul, cause you got a lion inside of those walls. Get up now, praise the Lord. Oh, come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me and lift up your soul. Cause you got a lion inside of those walls. Get up now, praise the Lord. again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, I'm nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah.
Let's pray together, church. Lord, we thank you that we get the opportunity to worship you. What an honor that is, God. Help us to see what an honor that is. Repent if there are defenses and barriers that get in the way every time that we worship. We lay that down this morning, God. We ask for forgiveness, for caring more about what people think or how we look, or even caring that we might look a little crazy. Lord, help us to lay that down and to truly pour out our worship to you. Every single day, in everything that we do, pouring out our praise. Because you are totally worth it. Lord, today as we step into a moment of interceding, we just pray for this church body, specifically for our Spanish brothers and sisters that will be worshiping after us. Lord, I'm thankful that we can be a church as one body with multiple different languages. I love that we can worship in our native tongue, but know that we are worshiping the same God, the one God who is worth it. So we pray for our Spanish ministries, Lord, that you would bless them in abundance, that you would keep us united. And together as a body, we pray the prayer that you taught us to pray, Jesus, by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Amen. At this time, the kids are dismissed to head back to Cove Kids with Miss Patricia. And to grow in their faith and in community with one another, what a joy it is to know that the Lord is blessing the opportunity that we have together around God's Word. In this room, we're going to dig into God's Word. We're going to turn to the same letter we were in last week, 1 Timothy. And we're going to be continuing from where we ended last week, 1 Timothy chapter 4, beginning in verse 10 and following through the end of the chapter. If you have your Bibles, love for you to turn with me there. If not, you can follow along with the words on the screen as we together hear the word of the Lord in 1 Timothy 4:10 following. That is why we labor and strive, because we have put our hope in the living God, who is the Savior of all people and especially of those who believe. Command and teach these things. Don't let anyone look down on you because you are young, but set an example for the believers in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity. Until I come, devote yourself to the public reading of Scripture, to preaching and to teaching. Do not neglect your gift, which was given you through prophecy when the body of elders laid their hands on you. Be diligent in these matters. Give yourself wholly to them so that everyone may see your progress. Watch your life and doctrine closely. Persevere in them, because if you do, you will save both yourself and your hearers. This is God's word offered to us in its reading and in its hearing, and together we give thanks, Lord God Almighty. Would you bow with me for a word of prayer? Gracious and loving God, what an extraordinary thing it is to meet with you, to hear from your word, and to know your presence with us and in it. Lord, we ask that as we approach this time of reflection, of learning, of proclamation, Lord, that you would be present with us by the power of your Spirit. We surrender to you in that way. I ask, oh God, that you would open our eyes, that we would see, our ears, that we would hear. Open our minds, we come to know and understand your word. Our hearts, that we would feel its power. Then I ask, oh God, that you would open our hands, that we would offer grace on your behalf to the world. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, one of the things that I like to do at the end of the year seems rather common. It's to look back on the year that was and take some stock, to look at the things that were challenges and those celebrations. I especially like to look at the celebrations. And as the pastor of the church, that's one of the things I like to do, is look at what has this last year been and what is there to celebrate. And I want you to know that as I look back over 2021, my favorite memories are of you. Of the ways specifically in which you have used your gifts to serve. 2021 was a time in which we were ramping back up into ministry, when we were deploying different serve teams fresh. And so many of you stepped in and served in ways that you hadn't served before. And I think about folks that had never been at the front door greeting, and then they joined the greeter team, and through their smile and their warmth and engagement, they were able to bless others. And I celebrate that. I think of folks that joined the refreshment team thinking, I don't know if I have the time to do it, but then they found a way to step forward and just bless the community with that warmth and fellowship. You have been a part of blessing me as I've witnessed your gifts being deployed. The most specific kind of manifestation of that was exemplified on Christmas Eve for me. On Christmas Eve, we had just kind of an all-hands-on-deck sort of mentality, particularly because we had some staffs that had experienced some illness. And Alyssa, our worship leader, was out sick, and so we had to make a call. But there's a backstory that builds up to that. You know, early last year, we put out a serve survey. Okay, and we put this survey out and invited everybody to respond in ways in which they're interested in stepping forward in service to the community and to the church. And there was a new box. For the first time ever, we listed, I'm interested in participating on the worship team. We had never done that before. That was the first time we ever did it. And so here's the backstory. So one of our lay leaders, Molly Dare, she saw that on our computer at home. She's filling out the serve survey, and she's kind of just chunking away. She's like, you know, checking it off her list. These are things I got to do. And then she got to that box, and she froze, just stopped in her tracks, didn't know what to do. And she was like, what do I do? What do I do? What do I do? She literally stopped, stood up, and walked away. I mean, this was like one of those moments, you know, you're knocking out your things to do list, and you're checking things off the list, and you're going to finish the service. She walked away, and she just started praying, God, what do you want me to do with this box? God, what do you want me to do with this box? And so then a few days later, she comes back to the survey. She skips the box. She goes all the way through the rest of the survey, and then she says, Lord, what do you want me to do? And here's how she describes that moment. She goes back to the box. She clicks the box, and then she clicks submit as fast as she can, and then she just runs away from the desk. I'm done. That was it. Hopefully no one reads the serve surveys, right? Like, because if no one reads the serve surveys, then I'm all good. Well, Alyssa read the serve surveys. And Alyssa reached out to Molly, and a season of development and training and study and preparation went underway. And Molly's been one of our leaders in worship multiple times, but it was exemplified for me whenever she stepped in on Christmas Eve worship, and Molly Dare offered her gifts to the Lord in leading the congregation and singing O Holy Night. What a beautiful thing. For the gifts of the people to be lifted up to God's glory and the impact that that could have. Generally speaking, I look at the church, and there are so many things to celebrate, but my favorite as the lead pastor is celebrating the number of preachers that we have here. I mean, it's crazy. Have you ever thought about it? There are five preachers at Covenant. There's me, there's Pastor Zach, there's Pastor Dario, there's Megan, and there's Peyton. We have five people that come before the body and proclaim the word, and I love it. I love it. I love hearing how God is moving through them. I love helping to raise up their preaching voices. It's extraordinary, but I need to share a celebration with you because you'll get where I'm going here in a second. Last week, we added a sixth person to the preaching at Covenant. And none of y'all got to, well, a couple of y'all got to see it as I'm looking at all the congregation. Anna Vargas preached in Spanish worship for the very first time ever last week. And it was awesome. I don't speak Spanish, but the Holy Spirit interpreted it, and it was awesome. And let me tell you what happened. After worship last week, there were three different individuals that came up to Anna after the sermon and said, I want to know more about God. I want to experience his love. I want a Bible. I want to be able to dig into his word. And so after worship, they were just passing out Bibles to folk. And I'm like, you need to come preach in English because people don't ask for Bibles after I preach. Oh, that's because y'all got seven on your coffee tables at home. I know how that goes. But I mean, it was beautiful. So now there are six preachers at Covenant. But get this, next week at Covenant, for the first time ever, we're having Youth Sunday. So youth in the church are going to be greeting at the door. They're going to be the ushers. They're going to be helping Patricia to serve back in Cove Kids. They're going to be doing what they can in the tech team. And we have two that are going to be helping to lead the singing and worship, and get this, we're adding a seventh preacher to the team next Sunday. Avery Crowley, sophomore in high school, is going to come forward and share her gifts with the body to the glory of God, and she's going to preach for us. You cannot miss it. It's going to be awesome. I mean, you got to be there, and I cannot wait to see how God uses next Sunday for his glory. If you haven't got it yet, the part of Paul's letter to Timothy that just strikes a chord with me this week is this word of encouragement for us in verse 14. In verse 14, the opening words just ring in my ears. Do not neglect your gift. Do not neglect your gift. And it's so easy to be tempted to neglect our gifts, right? We could come up with all sorts of grand excuses to neglect our gifts. We could say, oh, I don't have time to use my gifts. I'm so busy. My schedule's so intense. There's no way that I'm ever going to check that box or that I'm ever going to step forward in that way, because if I did, I don't have the time to do it. Or some of us might be tempted to neglect our gift because we feel like we're ill-equipped with knowledge. That man, I'm never going to talk about Jesus to anyone, because if I talked about Jesus, they would assume I know everything about Jesus. And I know the entire Bible. And if that expectation is going to come with it, I just can't even step forward and talk about my Lord. Well, that's a fool's errand. And then we neglect our gift. But the Lord will supply by the power of his Spirit words on your lips just to tell of the love of Jesus for you. But we use that lack of knowledge as an excuse to neglect our gift. Or maybe it's this excuse of comparison, right? Well, they're really awesome at that gift. Like, man, they are so funny, and I'm not that funny. And this gift of humor that I might think maybe something is stirring me in, nope, not going to use it because they're funnier than I am. And so we get caught up in this comparison game and use it as an excuse to neglect our gift. But Paul is so intentional here, so clear. He says, do not neglect your gift. And that's a specific invitation for Timothy, but I think that that's an invitation for all of us. What kind of gifts do you have? What might that gift be in you? Maybe you have a gift of encouragement. If you have a gift of encouragement, you know, whenever you see someone succeeding in something and you have a lens, the capacity to see it when others might not, and you don't even understand how they don't see it, but you see it, use that gift. Go to that person and share with them a word of encouragement and to build them up so that they would use their gifts more and more. Maybe you have a gift of encouragement. The Lord is telling you today, do not neglect that gift. Use that gift of encouragement. Maybe you have a gift of joy. You know, if you have the gift of joy, then you know. Because here's what happens. When you have a gift of joy, people like kind of gravitate to you because they need a little bit of joy like on them as well. And the joy that's in you just kind of spills over and other people are kind of washed into it. And so if you have the gift of joy, don't neglect that gift. Let it flow. Because the world needs it. And you are called to use it. Don't neglect your gift of joy. Maybe you have a gift of compassion. And you can enter into delicate and tender situations with such gentleness and love that there is a felt presence of peace whenever you enter. If you have that gift of compassion, don't neglect your gift. There's a gift that I know a lot of you have because I hear about it a lot, a gift of hospitality. If you have a gift of hospitality, use that gift. I mean, I have the pleasure of getting to call guests of the church, and whenever I call guests of the church over and over and over again, I get to hear about how warm and hospitable the church is and how what beautiful fellowship there is, and to God be the glory. And that's because many of you have the gift of hospitality. Don't neglect that gift of hospitality. Use it. Lean in. And God will be glorified in it. You see, we're not to neglect these gifts. We're called to use them. We're called to lean in. Yesterday, I was able to witness a group of people that individually, I don't know if they're fully in tune with what their gifts are, but I got to witness gifts in them. So yesterday was the UIL state competition for high school cheerleading. And some of you know my daughter is a senior in high school. She's the captain of the Tomball High School cheer team. And the game day team went to Fort Worth for the competition. And what happens is there's the prelims. And just like everything else, you know, it's 6A, you know, Division II, kind of like football. And so it's like the playoffs, right? But there's 63 teams that are all competing. And the prelims happen, and they all perform. And it gets whittled down to 20 that'll perform in the finals. And then receive awards. But here's how that works. You have the prelims, and sometimes you have something happen that just throws everything off, and that's what happened yesterday. In the prelims, Tomball High School, at the very end, the center stunt fell. You know, a stunt where there's two girls that are the bases, and then one that's the back spot, and then there's the flyer up in the air. And so they went to fly, and the girl missed the foot, and so she was one-legged, and then she kind of just sat into it, and this group of young women were devastated. They walked back to the hotel, and there was a ballroom area where they had their team meetings, and the parents were there, and they walked in. The parents all encouraged them because they did a fantastic job, but this one stunt fell, and as they walked in, I noticed that the girls that were in the stunt were weeping because they felt like they let their team down, and they felt like they felt like all the hard work that they had done was just going to be just washed away. So I sat back and I watched, and you know what I saw? I saw gifts being used. The first was a gift of tenderness. There was a young woman who walked over to one of the girls who was crying, and she just wrapped her arms around her and let this girl cry on her shoulder, and she cried and cried. And that gift of tenderness just moved the situation until she kind of stood up a little more straight and wiped off her tears. And then there was a gift of empathy. Someone came over and said, I remember when I used to be a flyer, and I remember I was at a pep rally in front of the entire student body, and I was flying, and I fell all the way to the ground in front of everybody, and I felt like a fool. But you know what? It's okay. I can get up and go again. And we're going to finals, and you're going to be able to get up and go again. And she gave that gift of empathy. And you could see confidence building. There was a girl that came over with a gift of humor. Said nothing about prelims, nothing about the stunt falling. She was just doing the thing, you know. You know the gift of humor person. They're like, they're just trying to make you laugh. And they're getting the giggle. And then they're getting the laugh. And then they're getting the belly laugh. And it's all getting better. Like, there's more energy and more liveliness coming about. Then there was a girl that came over with a gift of wisdom. And she's like, I remember last year, Magnolia dropped in the prelims. And then they went on in the finals. And they got third place. So it could happen. It's going to happen for us. Right? Like, so some of you are like the wisdom people, and I could see you're laughing because you know that's what you would do. And that's okay. To God be the glory, because your gifts matter, and God wants you to use your gifts as well. And then finally, there was a couple of girls that came over with this gift of energy, and it just infused the situation until I watched and the whole team experienced a renewal. Each one of these young women using their gifts uniquely, and the team was better for it. And you know what? They did go to the finals, and they went back-to-back as crowd-leading champions in the state of Texas, and they got second place overall in the entire state. And it would not have happened if those young women didn't use their gifts to bless each other. Oh, and that's why my voice is like this. Crowd-leading champions. I'm in the crowd. Ah, you know, going nuts. How cool to see people use their gifts. But the scripture is clear. We're not only to use our gifts. Paul is giving instruction to Timothy, and we see in verse 15, directly after this admonition, don't neglect your gift. In verse 15, he turns and he says, be diligent in these matters. Give yourself wholly to them. He doesn't want Timothy to use his gifts. He wants him to train up those gifts. And so what is that for you to be diligent in your gifts, to know that I need to focus in and know the ways in which I have been put on this earth to bless others. And whenever I have that understanding, to use it and to focus in on the ways in which it is most effective. And those diligent, focused individuals will grow in their gifts and grow in the effectiveness of their gifts. But it's not only diligence to the task. It's a perseverant spirit. It's a devotion to the task. This idea that I'm not going to waver, I'm not going to shy away from, I'm not going to lose a moment, but I'm going to give everything I have to the use of that gift. I'm going to aim at it. And in so doing, when I aim, I will hit the mark for God's glory. We're not just to use our gifts, but we're to train up in those gifts. And when we train in those gifts, God is glorified. And so each of us have these specific gifts. Now, some of us have similar gifts, but they're not identical, right? So two of you might be encouragers, but they're not identical. It's going to show up in different ways. And that's part of the beauty of the body. Each of us has a role to play, right? So all of us have these specific gifts, but we hear of, in verse 10, a general gift that all of us have as believers, as people who call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. So let's hear from verse 10 one more time. That is why we labor and strive, because we have put our hope in the living God. We've put our hope in the living God. And that hope is a general gift that every single Christian has. It's a general gift. We have this hope in the living God, this resurrected Lord, this Jesus, the one who defeated death, rose from the dead. Our hope is placed in him. And so we are called, get this, to use hope and to train up in hope. And I don't know about you, but I believe now more than ever, the world needs a little bit of hope. The world needs Christians who are able to step forward in difficult situations and point to hope, not despair. To point to victory, not defeat. And so what would it be for us to understand that we have this hope? It's been embedded in us as Christians. And in that hope, alive in us through Christ, we then use that gift to bless others. So that when we encounter those facing challenges or trials, despair or anxiety, we can point to Jesus and say, in him there is hope. There is hope for you as there's hope for me. There's hope for the world in Jesus if we would call on his name and invite that hope to permeate every. And we're called to train up in hope. And here's what I think that means. We're called to train in hope, which means when we experience hardship, when we experience anxiety, fear, despair, we are called to turn to Jesus so that we're no longer fixated on the downside, but we're able to point our attention to the upside. We're able to focus on how God, through Jesus, turns everything upside down, and he is indeed for us, even when we feel like no one else is. Turn to hope. Use hope as a gift and train yourselves up in it. Why? Why for all of this? Why use your gifts? Why train in them? Why use your specific gifts? Why use this general gift of hope? Paul answers that question for us at the end of verse 10. It continues on, we have put our hope in the living God, who is the Savior of all people, especially those who believe. And then it's stated again at the end of the passage that we read today in verse 16, persevere in these gifts, because if you do, you will save both yourself and your hearers. Why? Why use your gifts? Because there is power to save in them. We open the year talking about our collective missional calling to bear fruit that will last, eternal fruit that is kingdom oriented. And here's the truth of what we hear in verse 10. We might wonder, what does that actually mean? That there's a savior for all, but especially the believers. Here's what it means. Not everyone is saved, but, get this, but everyone has a Savior. Do you see that distinction? Not everyone's saved, but everyone has a Savior. You have never encountered a person in the world that doesn't have a Savior. We have hope in the risen Lord. He is risen indeed. And so since he is risen, everyone has a Savior. And so if everyone has a Savior and you know him, then when we offer our gifts to the world, others might be saved as well. How can you use your gifts, train in them, be filled with the hope of the Lord, so that we might see the world saved? How good will that be? That is our calling. That is our mission. That is our collective purpose, to bear fruit that will last. Fruit that we are called to participate in harvesting. All the work has been done in Jesus, and he has equipped you for the rest of the task. Let us use our gifts and train in them diligently and with devotion, so that God would be glorified and the world would know the gift of his love and his hope. Would you pray with me? Gracious and loving God, we do come before you just overwhelmed with joy that you have placed hope in us, that through the hope we have in Jesus, we have life, and that life is abundant and flowing. And so we ask, oh God, that you would use that hope in us to bless the world. How humbled we are, Lord, that you use us. How shocking that seems. Me? You would use me? Lord, thank you for using me. Thank you for using my gifts for your glory. Help me to lean in there. Lord, let none of us neglect our gifts, but help us to use them for your glory. Lord, I thank you for your son, Jesus. I thank you for your presence with us in community. And Lord, as those gifts are developed in us, Lord, use them for your glory in the world. We pray this in Jesus' holy and precious name. Amen. As we continue in worship, we enter into a time of offering. I'm going to invite the ushers to come forward. And as we give, Lord, we pray that God would use these gifts to his glory. And I'm thankful for all of you who give. May God be honored and glorified through the work of generosity in you. Would the ushers come forward at this time?
Let's stand together, church, as we sing a final song. together.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? His love is mine and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King of all kings. Just the Holy with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless and all in wonder. The King of glory, the King of all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love.
Together, worthy, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Let's give him praise this morning.
Amazing grace. Amen. My name is Megan Mazerol. I'm the director of Serve, and I just have a quick reminder for us this morning. So if you weren't here last week, we announced some changes that are coming to our neighborhood prayer networks. One of those changes being that instead of meeting weekly, we are now meeting monthly on the third Sunday of every month. And you guessed it, today is the third Sunday of the month. And so we will be having our neighborhood prayer network meeting today, and today at 4:30. Those of you that are members of the church and we have your email, you should have already gotten that Zoom link in your email. And you also got an email about a WhatsApp group to join for continual communication. And so I hope that you will hop on today at 4:30 and enjoy the fellowship that comes with praying together and praying together for our neighbors and the people around us. Would you receive now this benediction? God, we go forth from this place being people of hope with the gift of hope to share to the world. And so, God, we ask and we pray that you would lead us in all wisdom and all grace, showing us what it looks like for us to take that gift of hope that you've given us and to be an emblem of that constancy of hope to the world around us. God, you are so good. And we love you and we trust you. And we pray all of this in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Go in peace.